Mike is a geographical wonder. For 10 years, he's led NBR's energy security program on a wide range of subjects. And he's also a senior lecturer at the Graduate School of International Relations and Pacific Studies at the University of California in San Diego. And that's quite a stretch. We are delighted to have him here, and he will lead the next part of the discussion. And Mike, my only caution is be as close to that microphone as you possibly can, because you're at the end of the end of the table.
Yes.
Welcome. This is your part of the program.
Yeah. Thank you, Slade. Thank you. The governor is a very hard act to follow. You know, this is not an easy one to follow. The roots of the discussion today come out of a dilemma, a conundrum. If you want to use Alan Greenspan's famous conundrum, and that is the convergence of two things. One is this enormous surge in oil and gas energy production in the U.S. coming out of this new fracking technology, and I think we can. It's very difficult to really understand and appreciate the scale of this. U.S. oil production has increased by 4 million barrels of oil a day, just the increase, over the last 8 years or so. That's equal to more oil production than Iraq, than Iran. You know, we've, in a sense, added another Iran or Iraq to the world oil supply picture. These are staggeringly big numbers. And another million barrels of Canadian crude in the marketplace. So you've got North America bringing 5 million barrels a day of incremental crude to the marketplace. And this is the number one reason why we've seen such a huge price reaction. Natural gas, the same kind of story. A 20-fold increase in shale gas production. The Marcellus natural gas field in Pennsylvania, New York area, today is the world's largest single natural gas producing field in the world. It's bigger than Qatar's North Dome field production. It's bigger than the big West Siberian natural gas field individual. These are extraordinarily big numbers. And then finally, natural gas is eating into coal share, so you're suddenly freeing up all kinds of American coal, potentially, to move to other marketplaces. And that raises, I'll mention a whole set of other issues, but coal now becomes an important potential opportunity for U.S. exports and for Asian coal needs. You match this surge in production with Asia's growing energy security challenges, the need, increasing need for Middle East oil imports, Russian oil and gas imports that they need. So it's, a lot of people have mentioned this already. So you have this extraordinarily important need for our key allies in the region, Japan, South Korea, or at least our economic partners like China, that have enormous needs for this energy. The U.S. has this enormous surplus. We have key alliance partners who could benefit from this, South Korea and Japan. So this is essentially, from a market perspective, a match made in heaven. These resources need to move to Northeast or to Asia. From an oil company or, you know, my own industry experience, this is a no-brainer. The markets are perfect. But then there's a whole set of constraints that intervene here. U.S. policies on LNG exports have been an agonizingly slow process of approval over the last 6 years. You still have crude oil export bans, so we can't export crude oil to Northeast Asia or to Asia. When you talk about coal, we have constraints on trying to get that coal to tidewater on the West Coast for a whole set of political and social reasons. And this is the same set of dilemmas in a way that Canada faces in oil and gas, trying to get their resources to tidewater on the West Coast. You add to this, and I'll finish in a second here, you add to this enormous price change that we've seen, this huge price uncertainty that we're now facing. Crude oil prices in the mid-40s and could go lower. What does this mean for these markets? Does Asia really need this crude oil anymore? Do they want that LNG? LNG prices are down to $7 from 17 So what are the markets telling us about that? So one layer of uncertainty about Asia. And finally, coal and climate and carbon. Anytime you begin to talk about coal, you get into enormous issues of climate, cleaner coal, carbon capture and storage. The reality is Asia will use more coal. And the real question is, how do we try to find a way that that's cleaner and doesn't do the damage to the emissions picture and climate that we fear? So all of these, I think, uncertainties overlay Asia's energy security dilemma and our ability to provide those resources that would be extremely helpful. So with that long-winded introduction, we've got a terrific panel here, really terrific panelists from all over Asia as well as here in the U.S. I'll just do a brief introduction. I don't want to do long introductions. The bios are in your material there. We're going to start off with Shoichi Ito, who is a senior analyst and manager at the Institute for Energy Economics Japan. Any of you know energy in Asia, the IEEJ is the go-to place for serious work on Asia's energy picture and energy analysis. And Shoichi is one of the best in the group there and leads a great deal of their research. We have Masayuki Tanimoto, who is Director General, Oil and Gas Finance Department at Energy and Natural Resources Finance Group at Japan Bank for International Cooperation, JBIC. And if you know Japan, you know how important JBIC is in supporting and sponsoring Japanese investment, the economy, energy projects around the world, enormously important. And he's in the central hot seat in terms of providing that financing for energy projects. So we're lucky to have him here today. We have Mark Thurber, who's Associate Director of the Program on Energy and Sustainable Development at Stanford University. They do terrific work at the program. Mark is one of the leading experts on many of these issues. Mark, in a crass plug here.
Mark, thank you, Mike.
Just came out with a new book on the global coal market. And this is so important because the coal market is so poorly understood. It's an enormous part of our energy mix. It's going to continue to be. The question is, how do we deal with that and move forward? So this book is extremely important. I'll expect a check in the mail, Mark.
Right, yeah, no, yeah, it's on its way.
Then we have, from a Korean perspective, Sehyun An, who's Director of Center for Energy Security Strategic Studies, University of Seoul, and professor in the University Department of International Relations. Sehyun has been worked with NBR many times now on energy projects, really one of the leading people in the Korean energy picture. And then we have Sung-Kyu Lee, research fellow, head of International Information Analysis Division at Korea Energy Economics Institute. And KEEI is the go-to energy institute in Korea. So they're the place to go for this kind of thing. So we have a terrific group today. I've asked each of them to make a very short opening statement, 7 or 8 minutes. So we then have time for a discussion, Q&A, and so it's not just lecturing. We actually have a group discussion here on a table like this. So with that introduction, Shoichi, would you like to start off?
Yeah, okay. Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm Shoichi Ito, senior analyst at the Institute of Energy Economics. Japan. I've been working at the Economic Institute over the years with the background of political science. And I'm always happy to be back to my second home cell. Thank you very much, everyone. My colleagues at NBR and everyone else who welcomed me back again. I really appreciate that. Well, this is, you know, as always, such a big home coming to the place a part of my family is originated from. 7 decades ago, my grandfather went from here to join U.S. Marine Corps as a part of the occupation army in Japan. And he was recruited partly because he was such a great baseball player. And
you should see the tie, too.
So, if he didn't go there, I wouldn't have been, maybe not. So I really appreciate that. I'm also a great fan of Steve Mariners, but also the Seahawks and Huskies, of course. So whenever I come back here, especially here, just on the trip of UW, I feel so much excited. I just cannot overemphasize the rising importance of U.S. roles in the Asia Pacific as a security for a number of reasons. Nowadays, over the past year almost, oil prices relatively low. People tend to be sometimes over optimistic or over pessimistic about oil prices. As you know, oil prices just go up and down. We have made exactly the same mistakes over the years. I've been spending more than a quarter to sometimes the third of a year traveling all over the world. Wherever I go, people ask me, Shoichi, what do you think of the price months ahead? I wish I knew. If I knew that, I don't want to tell you. The place I should jump into is the Wall Street, of course. So, who knows? Well, I'd like to shed light on four big points we should bear in mind when we talk about U.S. rising strategic and historical opportunities in the Asia-Pacific theater. Number one, as many people have already noted, Asia, three of the biggest oil consumers over there, namely China, Japan, and the ROK, heavily dependent upon the Middle Eastern oil. Japan, together with ROK, importing 80% of crude oil supplies, much more than 80% of our crude oil supplies from the Middle East. As of today, China is importing roughly 60% of crude oil from the Middle East, and according to the IEA's estimates, the ratio is projected to increase up to 80% by 2030. Well, if you just look at the geography they face over there, they simply don't have alternative but to just look eastward, all the way to the North America. Well, for the past decade, actually, Russia increased crude oil exports from its eastern flank, and Japan's currently up to 7-8% of crude oil from Russia, but the maximum amount they could supply in the foreseeable future, even if oil prices rise, will be so limited in scale. People tend to forget about it because, as you know, the Russians spark something big without any concrete evidence behind it, but what they can do is so limited. Although they have vast of untapped potentials for both oil and gas. As for gas, they have huge gas reserves in Siberia, but infrastructure is underdeveloped. It takes years. Secondly, against such energy markets in Asia, especially Northeast Asia, the United States could contribute to stabilizing not only region but also global oil, gas, even coal market. You have massive resources, and the Asian countries just await the arrival of more supplies from North America. Thirdly, well, in so doing, the U.S. could reduce the energy factor as a potential source of regional conflicts. As you know very well, Asia is full of geopolitical rivalries, as we witnessed the East China Sea, South China Sea, between Japan and Korea, for some, in a sense, sometimes, you know, incomprehensible, anyhow, very complex reasons. I don't want to go into details, we don't have time. Anyhow, if that was the case, once all prices go up, once we will encounter the supply crunch with the growth of any of the economies, especially China, we will trigger competition for resources. If we have additional supply from North America, we could ameliorate, reduce such a kind of risky scenario. And also, it is a way we can probably engage the rise of China in a very constructive way. Because we are facing a number of issues, cyber, economic, general, energy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And energy is one of them. But we should learn lessons from history. Energy security has been addressed in the name of national security. So energy is one of the sources policymakers may well justify everything in the name of national interest. So reducing this element is super important. And also, we tend to forget what is happening with regard to Russia's geopolitical ambition to project influence in the Asia-Pacific side. I also work sometimes in Washington, D.C., and I've been writing extensively on the importance of encouraging trans-Pacific lands to encounter would be over-projection of Russia's influence in the Asia-Pacific side, especially at this moment of history due to the Ukrainian conflict. Policymakers, especially in Washington, D.C., even here, tend to look at Moscow through trans-Atlantic lens, trans-European lens. But what Moscow is trying to do is to boost its influence power on the Asia-Pacific front. Since the fall of the Soviet Union, we have neglected this factor all the years, so this is really high time actually to exploit the, in a sense, I'm not sure if I'm using the proper word, to exploit the weakness of Russia's positioning at this moment. And lastly, well, when we talk about energy security, everyone has different conceptualization of energy security. I'm teaching international politics and energy college once a week, and I teach my students, hey, energy security is such an interface of a jigsaw puzzle. You can bring together as many pieces as you want. Some people talk about the security of energy market per se, but this is really high time we should bear in mind. It is also important to note that it is the world of energy plus security. So by way of increasing energy supply to the Asian Pacific market, US could further reinforce its partnership with its allies, Japan and its ROK in particular. And maybe I overused one time. Thank you very much for your attention.
Good. Thank you, Shoichi. That's Shoichi is always wonderful at knitting together the energy with the strategic set of issues. Tanimoto, you want?
Thank you, Mike, for the kind introduction. And thank you very much, NBR, for giving me an opportunity and to speak in front of such a distinguished panel. And yes, as Mike introduced me, that you know, I'm the head of the oil and gas department of JBIC. And JBIC is the financial institutions 100% owned by the government. And so I'm located somewhere in between the, you know, Japanese policy and you know, practitioner as a, you know, banker. So I would like to give you the, some, you know, remarks on the oil and the gas sector which I'm dealing with in the viewpoint of the, some, you know, practitioner's point of view and the Japanese viewpoint. And regarding the oil, the, Ito-san accurately, you know, introduced already that the Japanese government recently announced that we need to diversify the source of the oil. You know, we, the Mr. Locke also said that you know, we depend 84% on the Middle East in 2014. And there was a historical, you know, coincidence when we, you know, start the high rapid development in 1950 or 60, you know, Middle East found a big oil field. So that's why, you know, they wanted the market, and we wanted those. So that's a kind of the, you know, natural coincidence that we, you know, heavily depend on the Middle East. And but we have been very comfortable because that we have a very good relationship with Middle Eastern countries. But now that we think that the situation has changing and deteriorating, especially in the situation in the Middle East, and we also concerned that the you know, non-state sector like Islamic states, they are really, you know, unpredictable. So I think that from my point of view, that the risk of the, let's say, Hormuz trade is, you know, getting bigger and bigger. So I think that's why the Japanese government recently announced that the policy. And there are two candidates in the, you know, Pacific for the diversification. One is Mexico. And it's natural because that you know, there's no choke point from the Pacific side of the you know, Mexico, and they have a very good, you know, investment environment and relatively stable, you know, political system. So Mexico is kind of the reliable partner for us. And also Mexico is looking for the Asian market because they lost the you know, U.S. market due to the shale revolution. So probably what we can do as a JBIC is we can support their, you know, development of the infrastructure, especially in the Pacific side, for the, you know, export of the energy. That is what we can do. And next one, second one is Russia, as Ito-san mentioned. And due to the, you know, they have an export pipeline, and Russia is already the fourth largest oil supplier to Japan. And probably it's going to increase. And also from the Russian side, they needed to develop the Siberia or far east side of Russia. And due to the sanctions and low, you know, oil and prices, they need money. So probably there's a room for the cooperation, even if there are sanctions going on. So in this regard, I'd like to say that you know, if the United States lift the ban of the crude oil export, that's going to be a very big, you know, game changer from the Japanese perspective. And I personally think that Russia, I personally doubt that whether Russia can be the reliable, you know, partner in the field of energy. I'd like to, you know, depend on United States. that's much better choice for us. So we expect that, you know, U.S. people can consider this aspect when you, you know, discuss about lifting the crude oil ban export. And regarding the gas market, there are a lot of things is happening. And actually, the diversification is okay. Geographical diversification is okay because we are now around 30% depends on the Middle East, and 20% of Asia, namely the Malaysia and Indonesia, and 20% in Australia, and 10% in Russia, the Sakhalin. And now we expect the much energy is coming from the United States. So basically we have achieved, you know, a kind of the good balance of the geographical diversification. But in the field of LNG, we are now trying to do is that the diversification of the price formula. And we used to use the oil-linked pricing formula. That has a good reason, because we LNG has developed as a substitute of the oil as a, for the resources of the power plant. So oil-linked oil-linked LNG price provide us the consistently a little bit lower price than the oil. So so that's why Japanese utilities are very comfortable with this formula. But we found that formula is not we shouldn't depend so much on this formula. So in this regard, we appreciate the new player of the North America, like United States independent producer, which produced introduced the Henry Hub priced energy formula. And at this particular moment, it is true that the oil price formula, oil-linked price formula is cheaper than Henry Hub, but still the diversification is very needed. So I think that that kind of movement is very much welcome. And that's a one point. And also in the LNG market, the flexibility is a kind of the keyword at this moment, because that we used to have a very rigid, or I should say rigid, or LNG market based on the long-term commitment of the highly rated Japanese utilities. That's because that they can predict the demand of the LNG very accurately, so they can make a very good commitment. So and their rating are very high. So from the banker's perspective, it's very easy to construct a kind of the project financing deal to promote that. But however, recently there are a lot of the uncertainty for the future energy demand, especially in the nuclear and renewables. And the nuclear power plant, now in Japan we have 48 nuclear reactors existing, and out of that 24 submitted for the restart of the operation, and just one has now started. But in that process, I found that 18,000 pages of the document was reviewed by the committee, and 62 review meeting was held in order to restart just one nuclear reactor. That was a quite long process, and probably nobody can expect when other a nuclear reactor is going to come back. And also renewable is a kind of the unstable source of energy by definition. So that makes also the calculation of the utility company very difficult. So it's very difficult for the utility company how much energy would be needed. So in that sense, now Japanese utilities started to ask the flexibility of the energy contract, especially the destination clause. And the destination clause is that, it's a typical clause of the energy contract. Basically, the Shell or BP or Qatar, they like that very much. And so if once we, utility buy it, you cannot redirect that energy to a third party. But now, this is also another, important point of the North American players, because American independent player doesn't care about this destination clause. So they offer the, destination free contract to the Japanese. So that's very important, and we appreciate that the American player very much. And in that regard, when we say that flexibility, I think that the point is that who is going to take this risk, because if it is the oil, then it will be easy to take a position and take a long position and sell it later. That would be you know, easy. But in the case of LNG, the cost of the storage is extremely high and risky. So it's very dangerous, you know, for somebody to take such kind of the, you know, market risk of the LNG market. And major players like Shell or BP, they started to do this kind of the portfolio strategies. And now Japanese utilities are demanding the, you know, change the destination clause. That means Japanese utilities also, you know, want to start this kind of the operation of the portfolio. And recently, TEPCO and the Chubu Electric has established a new company called JERA, and they combine the importation of the LNG and the upstream asset, and finally they are going to also integrate their IPP projects all over the world. So probably that what they are thinking is that they want to do this, you know, portfolio of operation with this vehicle. Yes, and also there is another possibility that the Japanese trading houses can play a role. But it's important from the banker's perspective that who is going to take this market risk of LNG would be the one of the main issue to formulate the, you know, shape of the future LNG market. Thank you very much.
You know, for an audience that's not steeped in LNG and those kind of markets and contracts, it gets complicated very quickly. Destination clauses and Henry Hub pricing and all that. Essentially, it's driven by the, you're talking about how you get a flexible marketplace that's not so stilted and rigid for LNG, that it causes much higher prices. You can't move it around the region. And that creates huge barriers to moving this important stuff around the region. So that's the LNG piece gets complex, but fundamentally it's vital for both Japan, South Korea, that they get a more flexible set of pricing and destination clause, all those kinds of things that make this stuff work better. And that's the importance of the U.S. side, is that we would provide LNG, which would help create, drive a lot of this flexibility in the marketplace. Let me give you one. I think one of the interesting Shuichi is that you painted a picture of U.S. energy resources helping dilute Russian influence in Northeast Asia in the next future.
Yes.
You want to elaborate a little bit on that?
Yes, I will have to.
And then, Mike, I want to follow up because the Russian issue is really fascinating.
Yeah. Why don't you throw your question in right now?
All right. Well, I'm going to spin a grand bargain idea, and you know, the energy security is such an enormous issue for so many countries. And when you mix in geopolitical factors, for example, it's not in our interest, I think in anybody's interest in Asia or anywhere else, to have a real cozy, imagine even an alliance between Russia and China, some alliance at a convenience for some shorter term period, whether they're acting in the Middle East or elsewhere. So what we do is, in spite of Russia's essentially fascism, we at the same time have to be smart about it. We got a problem, huge problem in Ukraine, maybe Syria now, and of course Russia's still in a state of war with Japan. Well, they never signed a treaty, and they got the northern territories there. But Japan's interested, desperately interested, in diversifying sources of energy. So imagine this. Imagine we're trying to accomplish some geopolitical goals, increasing energy security, solving some global political issues in the process. What if you did this? What if you combined on the European front, the United States, with Japan's support and others, a really tough policy with Putin in Ukraine, including the threat of introducing aerial bombardment of Russian troops and so on in eastern Ukraine. Just gave him an ultimatum. But at the same time said, we'll save face for you. Pull out, you know, some pseudo-federalists, federalism that really wouldn't accomplish Russian goals in Ukraine, give them some face-saving. At the same time, Abe agrees with Putin that they're going to solve the four islands, the northern territories, build the pipeline. That helps Russia diversify, you know, its economy's in a shambles. It gets to diversify its markets a bit. Japan gets in the process. We simultaneously open up our trade, willing to export whatever we're doing, build our ports here. I'm thinking geopolitically here. So in the process, we sort of buy off Russia and through a tough policy in Asia, in Europe, get it out of Ukraine. They save face, as I say. Putin gets two islands. Japan gets two islands out of the Northern Territory. They solve World War II, and they get a pipeline. Is that a pipe dream? What does Japan think about this? Is there such a grand bargain that we can pull off?
Well, thank you for your word in the Russian question. Actually, I've worked on the Russian issue for more than 25 years, including my early career working for the Russian desk at the MOFA. And first of all, so I guess my background, I have to make clear that the two alarm plus two alarms deal is now really acceptable for Tokyo. But we are not the stone. What Tokyo is calling for is to have Russia recognize Japan's sovereignty over the four islands. The actual return to Japan can be negotiable, as witness the experience of Hong Kong, for instance. And what they call 2+2 deal is something Russia takes 75% of the total territory, which are quite usable, and there are only 25 will be transferred to Japan, which are completely unusable. So this kind of deal is completely unacceptable. Anyhow, well, up until the outbreak of the Ukrainian crisis, actually in the Far East there existed three different energy concepts, including the one at Vladivostok, one with the expand on the Sakhalin 3, and the other with the Exxon Rosneft joint project with the Sakhalin 1. In a word, all of these projects have been dashed so far. And Vladivostok project was known as the single most expensive project ever. Putin wanted it politically, right, economically. Even Gazprom didn't like it. They gave it up. Second, as for the Rosneft Exxon deal for the Sakhalin 1, well, Rosneft has recently announced that they're just postponing it until at least 2021 or 2022. Due to the sanction, they can do it. Obviously, they're so low. We better ask ExxonMobil what they want to do with it. As for the extension of the Sakhalin 2 to help the third train, the United States has rightly extended its sanction against Russia to develop another field to provide additional supply, so they can do it well. And yes, as Mr. Tanimoto noted, so far Japan is importing 10% of energy from Russia. Maybe it's a good number. And it takes years to have additional supply from Russia. Anyhow, especially in the aftermath of the Ukrainian crisis. And I cannot also overemphasize that Putin is just hopeless. He has nothing to lose. That makes me worry so much. He will do anything. I mean, I don't have time to elaborate what is happening in the Russian economy, the power struggle in the Kremlin, but in the world, he will do anything, especially towards his next presidential election in March 2018. So now oil price is low, U.S. LNG suppliers are going back and forth, how fast they should advance the projects. Meanwhile, you know, Russia as U.S. potential competitor is just gone, at least for the next 5 to 6 years. It may aggression even more. So U.S. has such a golden opportunity to tap this opportunity. And well, by early 2020, Japan is projected to increase its energy import from the United States to around 20%. And in my calculation, it is really possible, if we make political decisions, especially to boost the duration of U.S. supply in Japan's LNG portfolio up to near 30%, together with additional supplies from, you know, Canada, else from North America as a total. That would be huge. And just lastly, in the world, we should not forget about the hidden importance of Alaska as a beachhead of U.S. rebalancing to Asia policy. I just came from angry this time, and you know, there's someone depressed against dropping oil prices. If you just leave it business as usual, it takes years. But what is happening over there? Yeah, the Strait of the Bering Strait. Russia is trying to develop Arctic Sea Route. The main reason is not commercial, to let the northern fleet cut across the Bering Strait free. China sent the first icebreaker 3 summers ago, and lots of geopolitical uncertainty is taking place. We cannot leave Alaska untouched from geopolitical and strategic perspectives. Thank you very much for that.
I think what's really important here is the interplay of geopolitical factors in these big issues. So I kind of threw out a grand bargain idea, but just to comment on what you just said, and just to, so everybody understands, Russia has reinvigorated, that's one word to put it, its hostile flights into, at Japan, armed military aircraft, probably on close to a daily basis, as if they're attacking Japan and then flying off. They did this throughout the Cold War, they're doing it again. So these kinds of, you know, there's Japan concerned about being surrounded by Russian and Chinese forces in the Arctic, as well as to their west. So they're kind of surrounded, in other words, by potential hostile forces with energy right in the middle of it all. So in any case, this is real. This is the real politics that Japan finds itself today.
Let me add another wrinkle to that, and that is because the sanctions and other actions have essentially eliminated the LNG projects that Russia planned to do. Lots of other reasons, but the technology they cannot get for those LNG projects. So Russia's only hope to move gas into Asia, rather than getting it to Japan and South Korea's LNG, is by pipeline to China.
I know.
So we're right. The effect is the energy side of it is driving Russia to throw itself into the arms of the Chinese, because that's their only gas market now because of the effect of the sanctions. The LNG, which could go elsewhere, is not going to happen. So,
hence my grand bargain idea, which makes that completely, you know, and not in Russia's interest.
Right.
They don't need to be any more dependent on a China that is gargantuan. Russia, in spite of its geography, is a pygmy, power-wise, compared to China. Not even a pygmy.
But that's effectively what's happening, is that the Russians are throwing themselves. They need Chinese money for these projects. They need Chinese investment, banking, you know, loans and investment. And that's the only choice they've got. So it's hard to get around that, the logic of that energy trade. Well, I want to get to our other speakers. How about if we move on to Mark Thurber, you got a little different slant.
Sure, yeah, I'll move us a little away from geopolitics. Although, although I will make the comment that it's hard for me to see China ever getting too cozy with Russia from a political perspective. But you're right, from a economic perspective, that may be driving that direction. And just another point that I think is interesting with regard to the Russia discussion is the way that low oil prices are contributing to making Arctic oil seem like a non-starter for a long time. So I just think that's an interesting new wrinkle, that Russia was certainly building that up a lot, at least in its own mind. And I don't think that's going to happen for a long time. So yes, but mainly I want to make a couple of points that are not geopolitical. And so, to the theme of how North America can contribute to Asian energy security, I want to look at two dimensions in particular, and one in which, and I'll focus mainly on the U.S., one in which the U.S., I think, has had a very salutary effect on Asian energy security, and another in which I think it's not having a positive influence at the moment. So the first one, we've alluded to it before, but just the fact that the U.S. has become such a producer of energy in the last decade, I think has been a great contribution. And in some sense, whether direct exports happen or not, if you look at the gas market, just by virtue of having so much domestic supply, those are LNG cargoes that, everyone was building regasification terminals in the U.S., and now none of those are being used, so those are cargoes that can go somewhere else. And so, I think by creating frameworks in the U.S. that are very supportive of the kinds of innovation that we've seen in unconventional gas and oil, that in some sense helps the energy security of all global energy consumers, whether things are directly exported or not. And I think Ambassador Locke made the interesting point that there's the direct way in which the U.S. is contributing just by augmenting supplies, but there's also the way of, whether it's exporting technology directly or maybe even beyond that, just by demonstrating that this unconventional extraction can be economic, just that demonstration, I think over the longer term will open up a lot more supplies around the world. And how quickly it happens in a particular place like China, where there's huge potential, and what direct part the U.S. plays is unclear, but much of that technology is really held by these services companies, and they go anywhere around the world that they want. So I think those have been very important contributions, and part of what has caused oil, gas, and coal prices all to decrease, in addition to the flagging demand. So I think that's been a positive contribution. The second area that I want to talk a little bit about, where I think it's more of a negative contribution, is in the incoherence of American climate policy. And I think the negative effect that is having. And, to me, I think that U.S. climate policy is weak in places where it should be much stronger. And I think it's strong in places where it should be much more nuanced, right? And so I'll kind of talk about two elements of that. One is, thinking about coal exports specifically, right? So the U.S. has a huge coal resource in the Powder River Basin in Wyoming and Montana. Right now exports look unfavorable just on the economics because coal prices are very low. But, assuming that those rebound at some point, the question is whether the U.S. can successfully build terminals in Washington State and perhaps Oregon to facilitate exports to Asia. And so this is really a conundrum that's, hitting on some of the points that we've talked about, which is, coal is arguably the biggest contributor to climate change. And so that's a real problem. I mean, it's a real global problem, and it's a real local problem as far as air pollution from burning coal in different places. You know, on the other hand, trade is a good thing. And the other piece of that is that this coal, that there are a number of countries that are going to need coal for quite some time. The U.S. is probably not one of the countries that should most need coal because we have a lot of affordable alternatives, but many countries don't. And this was just driven home to me. I was in Zambia in the southern part of Africa over the past couple weeks on a totally unrelated research project. But there's a real electricity crisis there because it's in drought and it's a hydro-dominated system. And so we had electricity about half of the time, you know, even in kind of moderate-sized towns. And it's really a problem. And there's really nothing except coal that could help supply that additional generation. And so that's something, and in fact, there is a coal plant that's sort of slowly making its way towards turning on. But it really, you know, just in a personal way, kind of emphasized to me that you know, poor countries like that, there are really no alternatives. There's nothing else Zambia can do. Natural gas is unrealistic. Nuclear is unrealistic. Renewables are unrealistic. So, you know, they need coal, and it's a very poor country, and so that's a reasonable place for it to be burned. That being said, it needs to be burned with the sort of local pollution controls, and I'll kind of talk about that in a moment. So I think. And yet, we're sort of stuck with this situation where it's very difficult and resisted to export coal from the United States. And frankly, I'm somewhat sympathetic to the environmental groups that are trying to block these ports, just from the perspective that because, you know, our country is not acting in a coherent way as a whole, you know, the strategy of these environmental groups has been, well, we're just going to block in every forum that we can find, we're going to block coal infrastructure as well as other energy infrastructure, which I think ultimately is not a very efficient way to make policy, but that's sort of the default that we have right now. And so that's where I think, to the extent that the U.S. can become more strong and more coherent on our national carbon policy, putting in a price of carbon that's across the country, you know, doing something to show, you know, we're doing the steps we need, but now that we've done that, you know, let's trade and let's get resources to people who need them more than we do. So that's kind of one part of it. The other piece that goes a bit along with that is, you know, if I would say that the U.S. has been much too weak on our own domestic climate policy, I think we've been strong in the wrong ways in trying to affect other countries' policies with respect to coal. So the U.S. has really been pushing to block investments in coal plants in other countries, so along with various European countries. And that, I think, is counterproductive. And for, you know, another dimension of energy security, and probably the one that is most, you know, that's the most critical to those who are affected by it, is this issue of access to power. So just what I was talking about in poor countries. And, you know, so if we're saying, well, you can't have coal, all you other countries, but we're not giving you any other alternative, that's just an incoherent policy, and it's, you know, and it's negatively affecting energy security of those countries insofar as it's preventing them from getting power plants online. And so just a piece I would say with that is that I think, you know, energy security for those kinds of countries, it's both about getting the energy generation online, but it's also about getting it online cleanly. Right, because I think China is a great demonstration of how, you know, there's an energy security problem in China associated with local pollution from coal, right? And so that's, you know, coal is not going to be sustainable and politically acceptable in these kinds of countries until you also have those local controls. And so I would much prefer to have the U.S. say, you know, well, look, we're going to support where it's appropriate coal plant development in other countries, but part of that is going to be not saying that you have to do CCS, but saying that, that we have to figure out a way to get all the local pollution controls in place on those plants. And so, you know, my hope is if there's more coherence in how the U.S. is thinking about, you know, climate and access and local pollution, that you know, we can have a situation where, you know, action on climate doesn't have to seem, you know, like it's in total conflict with free trade and access to energy. So.
Thanks, Margaret. That's why I'm one of the reasons I'm really glad that you're here, because, and I'd be interested in reaction around the table about. Mark said at one of our recent conferences, he said, I thought I'd never say this, but the fact is we have to learn to embrace coal.
And,
In the right way. and this is a real problem in our policy. This is a misunderstanding that's so widespread about the energy problems and the importance of electricity in all these developing countries. To education, to economic prosperity, to health, you can go down the list. Without electricity, you get none of that. And so we have to figure out how to use coal wisely.
Yeah.
But the notion that we won't finance coal power plants, even clean ones, that we won't export coal, this is just simply a victory of hearts over minds. This is kind of, I admire your intentions, but that's, you're going about it exactly the wrong way.
Well, as we discussed a little bit yesterday, what that leads to is, you know, we talked about sort of this magical thinking where there become two levels of dialogue, right? There's the level of dialogue that's sort of what everyone's talking about publicly, right? And so here's how we're going to solve our problems, and it's kind of a dream world. And then there's this level of dialogue that's the people financing actual projects. They're the, you know, the developers, the companies, you know, the private equity funds, you know, all those kinds of things. And they're just operating in a completely different world. But because of that, you know, you get a lot of stuff that it's sort of non-transparent, because nobody feels like they can talk about what they're really doing because it's so at odds with this, you know, sort of fanciful level of dialogue. But, you know, and so I still think we need to embrace coal, but I also think a big piece of that is until we get serious about climate, I'm not going to tell any environmental group that you should embrace coal, right? Because they have a good argument saying, look, you know, we're on the highway to disaster. Nobody's doing anything. You know, you start doing things first and then tell me to embrace coal. And that's a fair argument.
So. Mm-hmm. I mean, you look at the energy plans from Indonesia to Malaysia to Japan and South Korea.
Yeah.
Their implied energy plan shows more coal use 20 years from now. That's the real dilemma that policymakers are facing, not the fanciful, magical thinking of some of the environmentalists.
Yeah.
That policymakers have to find a way to provide energy, electricity in particular, and, you know, the other choices aren't scalable or affordable. So, you know, this, I think, is, I guess your argument is the U.S. and Europe and others have to reduce their coal use to make room in the system, in effect, for more coal use in the developing countries, because simply that's what's going to happen.
Yes.
Yeah.
And any thoughts around the table? There are a few people that may have some contrary thoughts.
Here. I need to say something as a person of the NBL country. Let me publish an article entitled "The, you know, revisiting the importance of coal as a new, the black diamond." Well, I'm glad Mark quickly noted that there exists a way to use coal properly. Environmentalists tend to forget everything to do with coal is bad. It's not the case. And we are already talking a lot about geopolitics today, especially if you just pay attention to the future geopolitics of Asia, especially Southeast Asia. What's going to happen? Well, unlike oil and partly unlike gas, coal is widely dispersely located in the world. Many emerging nations have their own domestic coal, including Southeast Asia. Vietnam, for instance, is projected to turn into net importer of coal in several years, and likewise for many other Asian nations over there. What if they ban them to consume coal effectively, if incorrectly? It might add fuel to South China Sea's geopolitical, dangerous games. And, the people tend to be over-focused upon the availability of CCS, whose commerciality is questionable, yes, in the next decade at least, or beyond, but there exist many technologies to burn coal more cleanly for the thermal plants. And, China has been doing a great job to advance their own domestic clean coal technologies. They're introducing a bunch of supercritical thermal combustion technologies, meanwhile shutting down old, outdated small and medium plants. Meanwhile, they are exporting massive scale of less advanced subcritical technology to Southeast Asian nations. This is a reality. And what I'm trying to say is, to the extent we need to accept the reality, a realistic importance of coal, it's more wise to talk about how we can use it in the correct way, in a better way, instead of having black and white scenario.
Any comments from the group? I can't believe we don't get a reaction to advocating coal use. Yes.
I'll just speak up so I don't need a microphone, but I think Richard, your grand bargain notwithstanding, which was some terrific thinking, and there are great geopolitical opportunities here, and by the way, you probably should have been in New York at the UN General Assembly earlier in the week. Probably could help the Obama administration. It's great. Bring that argument to Washington State and put that in the debate that we're facing. I'm not so sure it gets us across the goal line. That is the community that Mark's talking about that's opposed to this. I don't think that's a win for them, right? They need to see what Ito-san is talking about, progress on technology. So I just wonder if anyone has any thoughts. Senator Gorton is just known for facilitating bipartisan dialogue, and how do we get a rational discussion going in Washington State about this issue where it doesn't become a partisan divide and people come off their entrenched positions? It's just, I think that's the trick we need to somehow solve in Washington State.
That's a big we've been talking across purposes for a long time. The problem is the talk is about what we do, actions. The disagreement is a level below that. It's on policies and perceptions. And those are much more difficult challenges to deal with. I'd be happy to have your idea whether there's a way through that. If you start from different premises, it's very difficult to agree on what the actions are to be.
Yeah, just a comment. I think a good portion of the environmental activist community decided at some point, and you read things about this, to put all of its support behind one political party. When you look at the generation of leaders prior to the current ones, there was a lot of bipartisan support for compromise environmental issues. And with the decision really to support one party versus the other, it's made this what really is a complicated kind of gray issue into black and white. I think that's a real difficulty, and it's going to take, I think, a new generation of leaders, those like the Dan Evans and Slade Gortons and so on, and Gary Locke, I mean, the kind of the bipartisan workers, leaders from this state. It's going to take a new generation to say, you know what, we're going to have to compromise on these things. That's kind of the difficulty. There's this partisanship. Mark, you want to talk about that? I don't know. You probably live and breathe it, certainly in California.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, I think that's a great point, and it gets discouraging at times, right, because you just, you know, I think one example to me is at a national level, you know, my view is that a revenue neutral carbon tax, there's no reason why that ever should have become this, you know, toxic issue that it is, because in many ways, you know, this is a market mechanism. We're going to refund the money, so it's not going to grow the size of the government. And, you know, the fact to me that we can't pass something like that is just very discouraging. And I don't know, you know, maybe one of the strategies is if the Clean Power Plan becomes a big enough mess that people say, okay, let's just do a carbon tax and be done with it. But, I don't have a great solution. I mean, I think what you said about the next generation is true. I mean, my impression is that, for example, the existence of climate change is a much less partisan issue in the younger generation today. That kids of both political stripes, you know, kind of accept that this is happening. But when that gets into policy, I don't know. Clara?
Yeah, I was going to say, building on your question as well, I think there's a very interesting connection there between the points that both Mark and the Senator raised about these two different levels of dialogue, but that also tie back to the two different issues we've really seen come out of both the sets of panels so far, which is looking at the shale gas revolution and this very easy perception in the United States to say, great, we have much more gas, so we're done, right? We don't need coal, no one else needs coal, and really assume from there that others have adapted this fully as their supply, which they have not in Asia, it's not in Asia. One of my other favorite hobbies, being based in Washington, D.C., I'll often quiz different people and say, okay, shale gas revolution has dramatically lowered the percentage of coal in our energy supply. Where do you think it's at now? Yeah, the numbers I often get are, 3%, 5%. Mike, do you have... The number now, is it 30%?
It's around 30-something.
It's about 30%.
Yeah. And most people, it just does not connect with them how much this is still a role in our daily energy supply.
I think that's a really excellent point that you bring up, Clara, because I think... I mean, that there's a real sense of triumphalism, I think, in the U.S. Environmental community right now, that coal is dead. Look at it. It's done in the U.S. And now, you know, the idea is it's done in China, too, right, which is really, that's a really dubious contention. And I think the reality is nobody understands very well right now exactly what's happening in China. You know, is it the economic growth and the demand has dropped much more than we expect? But you still look at China and you know, what's supplying anything more they need, it's still coal, I mean, for all they're doing on nuclear and gas. So, I think that point is right on, and it's just this huge disconnect between the environmental community in the U.S., which thinks we've demonstrated that coal is done, but it's all because of shale gas that coal is, done-ish in the U.S. But it's still not done. I mean, yeah, it's like 30-something.
Well, even there's a lack of acceptance that natural gas is beneficial.
Yeah, yeah.
Backing out coal. I was in a meeting recently where somebody said, what are we going to do about this curse of this massive abundance of natural gas? And my head almost exploded. Yeah. But that's the perception. So coal is not, you don't do coal. Natural gas is not a good thing either. It's this absolutism about, it's only renewables, it's only efficiency. And I don't want to get on a hobby horse about this, but I think this is really a difficult thing to reconcile.
And you know, the whole Clean Power Plan is essentially structured around the fact that natural gas is able to back out, you know, a certain amount of coal, right? If you look at the three kind of building blocks that they have for your state, right? One is, you know, okay, increase the efficiency of your coal plant. Okay, that's fine. Number two, and by far the most important, is, you know, increase utilization of gas plants relative to coal ones. And number three is, you know, increase renewables or whatever else relative to coal. But it's all structured around backing out coal and largely on the back of our luxury of gas, right? So
we are I'm doing a very great disservice to our last two panelists here.
Mariana?
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. You can bring me back here. I want to think you had a comment about, thank you, hearts over minds. And it gets kind of to what Mark was talking about as well. Several years ago when I worked for a member of Congress, I went to China on a renewable energies staff delegation visit. We visited Inner Mongolia, Jilinho, saw the wind farms. We went to Nanjing and saw the sun systems, which later went bankrupt, I think, and is being redone. And we saw Slade's favorite, algae production at the University of Nanjing. And it's true that all of the pollution is something that is visible. Climate change is something everyone acknowledges. But Governor Locke made the point about energy poverty, that somehow we are not, when we see a three-year-old Syrian boy drowned, it moves us to action. When we see a little girl in Vietnam on fire, it moves us to action. Civil rights, same thing. How do you show pictures of children in yurts dying from indoor fires because what they burn is dung? How do you show malnutrition deaths? How do we equate that? I don't believe our environmentalists are bad in their intentions, but they're not seeing that there are many other, it's kind of a reverse NIMBYism. We got ours, now you can't have it. So how do you approach that, putting climate change on the same level as some of these other issues, particularly in China?
Mark, you wanna?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that's definitely a challenge, right? And certainly, I mean, I think the US policy, I mean, you know, they're not consciously going through the steps of we got ours, now you can't have yours, but that is implicit to a degree. I mean, especially with the idea that, well, you can't build any coal plants. You know, I guess the issue with, you know, indoor fires, I mean, I think that's a very important health issue, although it's a little bit different, you know, in some, maybe from just getting power to people. I mean, maybe a broader problem is, you know, when I go to, like, when you go to poor communities in countries like Zambia, I mean, the people who are off-grid, you know, as long as they're healthy, right, it's not exactly a destitution, right? If you're always used to not having lights, you know, you're not going to look at someone and see, well, that, you know, they're actively suffering from not having lights. It's more, you know, maybe it's more of a refusal to acknowledge that growth is a good thing, right, that economic growth is valuable. And I think that's a bit of the challenge that the, you know, if you have disease or famine or like you said, the respiratory issues from indoor cooking, you know, those are very tangible, that these are kids sick and dying. The fact that they're not, you know, growing and that the economies don't have, you know, the benefits of reliable power, it's not quite as tangible, but it's certainly real. So that's a good question. Maybe I don't have a good answer on exactly how you dramatize that. But I mean, actually going to one of those places and being frustrated that you know, you can't get power, the toilet doesn't flush because the electric pump is not powered up. That's one way, but it's expensive to send everyone over there.
I mean, there's so many ways that we don't recognize how important. How do you keep medicine? If you don't have electricity, you don't have a little refrigeration. You can't keep medicine that spoils very quickly. Things like that. When you fish, you can't save the fish very long because it rots if you don't have a minimum of refrigeration, and that requires electricity. This feeds into the very fundamental quality of life and opportunities for these people in these countries. And we just don't see that unless you're out trundling around, and how many people actually do that.
Yeah, Mike, there's nothing like going into a severely less developed area of the world. Simply the food waste. First of all, you know, that there isn't going to be as much abundance of food, but the amount of food waste without refrigeration. And even today in rural parts of China or India, not to mention some of the smaller countries, the food waste is astronomical without refrigeration. Piles of it rotting away. It's just inconceivable to somebody from a developed country that there would be so much waste. That's just one of those tangible things. Mariana, one of the things you could do is just go piles of food rotting in less developed countries. So it's unbelievable.
Yeah. I hate to shift, but we're doing, as I said, a real disservice to our last two panelists. So, and I've asked them to be as brief as possible. It's really unfair to leave you like this. I apologize profusely. So please go ahead, and I apologize for...
Okay, I'll do my best to be very, very brief. Yeah, it is with my profound honor and privilege to be here. I'd like to extend my sincere gratitude to the NBR and also the Korean Embassy in Seattle for inviting me at this roundtable discussion. I feel very blessed to give a talk at this seminar. Let me remind you that I will look at more broad geopolitical and strategic implications of energy diplomacy between ROK and the U.S., whereas Dr. Lee will deliver more detailed transaction between the two sides. Before I get into the energy diplomacy between the United States and South Korea, it is very important to understand that Korean Peninsula is located in the middle of between the Energy Continental Power Group and also Energy Sea Power Group. And recently, following the shale gas revolution, the South Korea was actively courted by both sides to join each of these two energy groups. And from the Energy Continental Group, as you know, the Eastern Siberia turns out very promising region considering its massive oil and gas reserve, especially the gas reserve. If you look at the Kobikta gas field has more gas than the entire nation of Canada has it. So it's quite tempting for us. And also, if you look at the short distance advantage between Eastern Siberia and the Korean Peninsula, from the energy security perspective, the distance factor really matters, as the Russian-German energy rapprochement demonstrated in the past few decades. So recently, the natural gas pipeline project linking two Koreas and Russia has been actively brought to the diplomatic table, and also still remains the focal point of Northeast Asian energy security cooperation. But nonetheless, from the South Korean energy security perspective, how to build a strong energy alliance with the United States is South Korea's foremost important energy policy priorities and the new energy security agenda. The ROK and the United States could elevate the current strong, the blood alliance beyond up to the level of a special energy alliance. This is more convincing considering the fact that the two sides has already made free trade agreements. Specifically, two sides could actually tighten up the energy alliance with the transfer of the U.S. natural gas or crude oil as well as coal. In fact, starting from 2017, the ROK will receive 3.5 million tons of natural gas from the U.S. for 20 years. Also, we could increase the import volume up to 15 million tons of gas, which is equivalent to 20 BCM. Also, perhaps the U.S. could use also the Korean natural gas terminal to expand its Asian export market in the longer term. But as far as the benefits of the U.S.-Korean Energy Alliance is concerned, in comparison with the Sino-Russian Energy Alliance or the potential, the Sino-Russian-Korean Energy Alliance through the pipeline mechanism, the U.S.-Korean Energy Alliance could create more reliable and more predictable and more flexible and more sustainable energy market system based upon the high level of confidence between the two sides, which have earned from the decades of strong political and also military ties. In particular, I'd like to point out that as the golden age of natural gas has started, the natural gas related cooperation, including LNG transfer and also the collaboration over the gas related industry, such as gas automobile industry between the two countries, seem to be quite promising. And also, as far as the transportation cost is concerned, it is interesting to point out that the transportation cost of natural gas from the U.S. Gulf Coast to the Korea is much lower, cheaper than the transportation cost from the Gulf Coast to California by trolley. So furthermore, it is essential to anticipate the possible U.S. crude oil transfer to Korea, because Korea is in a great position because we already set up some free trade agreements. So we are very keen on the U.S. light crude oil in particular. So also we are closely looking at, we are closely monitoring the development of the Keystone XL pipeline and also the U.S. energy and environmental politics mechanism such as HR 702. Also, let me also point out that already the eastern part of Korean Peninsula has transformed significantly in reaction to the shale gas revolution in the United States. We began to build the new energy hub city, which is called Samcheok. In other words, Korea is looking at the possibility how to establish a global oil and gas hub in Northeast Asia, because Korea is where the future massive amount of Russian gas and the U.S. gas will be imported simultaneously. So Korea posits a perfect location to build a global scale of natural gas import and export station. Secondly, I'd like to point out that aside from natural gas and coal trade between the two sides, the United States and South Korea also could share some common interests to develop offshore energy resources in Northeast Asia, specifically the joint development zone area between which was set up between the Japan and ROK. This offshore development issue was actually, the idea of the offshore development issue, especially in the JDZ, was actually first raised by the U.S. State Department when Ito and I participated in the U.S. Embassy in Japan's public diplomacy program for the possible framework for the trilateral energy alliance between the U.S., Japan, and South Korea. So quite frankly, there is no active offshore energy resource development in the Korean offshore area at this stage. But as you know, there are massive, massive gas reserves in joint development zone in the East China Sea, which is also linked to the China's biggest offshore gas field, which is called the Chunshan gas field. So the U.S. and Japan has a strategic interest in the East China Sea, and perhaps the trilateral cooperation over the JDZ could really facilitate and also could promote South Korea's involvement in the East China's sea. And also we could also boost up some maritime alliance or the energy alliance among the three countries. And perhaps the U.S. and South Korea also could also work on framing energy security in the DPRK, including oil exploration in the DPRK offshore area in the future. Speaking of North Korean energy issues, I strongly believe that the DPRK energy assistance program could turn out a very important key component of the U.S. and Korean energy transactions in the future. In other words, how to frame DPRK energy security is a very important task for the South Korean government, and also the five-party talks member among the six-party talks member is North Korean energy security is considered to be the one of the most important, the regional energy security agenda. As you know, the DPRK's biggest domestic problem is energy shortage problem. So it is quite essential for the Korean government and also for the U.S. government to prepare for some sort of energy security framework for DPRK, also for the possible reunified Korea. But right now, it is quite fair to say that the DPRK's the energy security has completely collapsed and also desperately in need of foreign assistance at this moment. So accordingly, as I spelled out in my recent article at the Asian Survey, the natural gas remedy seems to be a perfect solution to solve the DPRK's energy shortage problem. Due to its diverse supply options, either from Russia or from the US, and also it could reduce the DPRK's energy dependence on China and also Russia too. But before the shale gas revolution in 2009, the Russian gas seemed to be the only option for DPRK's energy providing assistance program. But now the US actually can bring its own natural gas car to the negotiation table with DPRK. So also, because of due to the time limit, I would like to briefly mention about the another possible energy cooperation between the US and ROK.
We started late, so we're going to...
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Got a little room.
Okay, thank you very much. Also, the United States and South Korea could also can collaborate on the nuclear power issues. So the exchange or the transfer of the nuclear technology seems to be quite substantial. Aside from that, the two countries also could work on nuclear safety issues, such as setting up some information exchange framework or setting up some preventive joint drill exercise or other regional cooperation projects. So for my closing remark, the United States and South Korea share a lot of strategic interests in terms of both energy security and also the regional security. So it is important to understand that the energy trade between the two countries are not purely based upon the commercial interest, but based upon very strong blood alliance and also the confidence between the two sides. So therefore, we need to elevate the current energy cooperation up to the another level. So specifically, we can focus on the stable supply of energy resources. Also, we can focus on the joint exploration and production of offshore resources in the East China Sea. Also, we could work on the stable management of a nuclear power generation. But in particular, as the natural gas golden age has finally arrived, the natural gas cooperation between the two countries is quite essential. And also, finally, we also need to keep in mind that we could solve the North Korean problem with this specific natural gas car. Thank you.
Thank you, Sehun. That was a wonderful knitting together of the commercial issues as well as the strategic dimensions. Rich, I know you've got a very strong set of views on North DPRK, RLK. I'm going to give you the opportunity here.
Plus, your life expectancy in the DPRK for a variety of reasons is quite short. So I don't know how far I'd venture in, but we can talk about the DPRK. I think that's, but I really appreciate that. You know, it's interesting. China utilizes its pipeline of oil into the DPRK for, you know, it uses it for tremendous political leverage at times. And it's interesting to think about if you had another pipeline going in from the south, say LNG comes in, and then you pipe it to the north, what leverage that might give. Of course, you're charging them for it. This isn't an assistance program, because all that's going to do is assist their nuclear program and everything else you want to help. But you charge them for it, and world prices for it. It'd be fascinating. That's really interesting.
But just brief comment, because the DPRK actually really envies the U.S. and Vietnamese relations. So I think there we still have some chance. Yeah. Okay.
Dr. Lee, I'm sorry to keep you at the end and try to shorten. Just do the best you can.
We have some time.
I say 5 minutes, time limitation. Currently, Korea energy companies are import U.S. Energy, such as coal and condensate, from 2017 LNG. So I will say especially only about the coal. In case of energy consuming at the countries, the important factor are growth rate of demand and supply security and diversification of import source and price. Korea coal demand is on upward trend. According to second National Energy Master Plan, coal demand will rise at the average rate of 1.2% for years until 2035 year. In growth of coal use this year in Korea reflect soft seaborne coking coal and some summer coal price. Coking coal price have slumped to $110 a ton from more than $300 in 2011 year. Coal account for nearly half of a total power supply in Korea. Despite the resumption of operation at some suspended nuclear reactor, coal demand in Korea is expected to increase by 5.2% in this year, as the power generation companies add more than 2,000 megawatts of coal-fired generation capacity. The shale gas evolution in the U.S. has created a massive surplus in growth and global supply of coal. And the coal demand from core markets such as China and India started to weaken. During shale revolution, Korea's import of U.S. coal increased past from 30,000 tons in 2007 to about 7 million tons in 2012. But since then, import volume from U.S. Is decreasing because of weakened economic growth of China and Korea, and energy price drop. And I know that Asia's share of U.S. Coal export increased from 2.2% in 2007 to 25% in 2012. Almost all of the U.S. coal exported to Asia went to China, Japan, India, and South Korea. But coal global analysts contend that Australia coal producers are well positioned to capture market share of coal export from higher cost producer. Therefore, they do not curtail production with high speed in the situation of low coal price. Currently, the share of U.S. coal in Korea total coal import account for in Korea 3%. In case of U.S. coking coal, 12%. Almost all coal imported from U.S. in Korea is coking coal. The price of U.S. coking coal is higher than those of both Australia and Russian coal. But in the aspect of diversification of import source, it is necessary to maintain a certain share of import coal from main countries such as the U.S. In the low price situation, Korea coal analyst does not expect Korea's import of U.S. coal to rise sharply due to higher transportation cost. So the price of U.S. coal needs to be low enough to offset the higher transportation cost. But the U.S. coal would boost Korea leverage in negotiation with Australia and Russia in partner. I think that export terminal in western of U.S., such as Seattle, the good place to decrease transportation cost from U.S. to Northeast Asian countries. As you know, there are not many energy export terminal from LNG, coal, and condensate. Many energy export in terminals are located in, I know that, the Mexican Gulf area. So, Korean energy companies and government consider U.S. energy as supplier of more credible than Russia and Middle East countries, and think that the U.S. has a big potential for supply to Korea and Northeast Asian countries to increase the share of U.S. coal, LNG, or another energy in Northeast Asian market. Thank you.
Thank you. You know, that just brings home the point of the importance of U.S. LNG, the importance of coal exports in the diversification of Korea's energy supply. And it also is an issue of gaining leverage over your other suppliers to keep those prices in line. So it makes it, there's more to it than just selling some coal to Korea. This has a whole broader set of benefits, diversification, and leverage for other buyers. Same with LNG, same kind of thing. U.S. LNG is extremely competitive with contract terms that are so flexible compared to the others. So I think it brings that to a sharp point. The other thing you can see in Korea's energy plan is the same thing that we talked about, is gas, LNG is expensive, renewables are difficult to scale and relatively expensive. Nuclear is constrained in Korea because of problems, scandals, and other things, so that nuclear has real constraints on how much you can grow nuclear. So you get pushed back into that trade-off where coal becomes the default choice. And you see this in Japan, you see this in a whole set of places. You see it in Europe in a very big way. You know, Germany is actually building lignite coal-fired, the worst coal you can think of, lignite. They're building new lignite-burning power plants. At the same time, they're forcing renewables into the system and importing Russian gas. It's the most mixed-up set of incentives you've ever seen. But the UK coal use is rising. Similar set of constraints. And so, we've got to find a way to embrace coal responsibly.
Mm-hmm. I'm obviously not an expert on the geology and chemical makeup of different supplies of coal. But we do hear that North American coal tends to have less sulfur, it's cleaner coal. To what extent does that enter market decisions around Asia?
Yes.
Can I just comment on that? Because I think I'll answer that while you ask the question too. as a person that has this pending for 15 years, I'm sure I guess business in Pittsburgh and Barcelona, Sierra Leone. I came back to Korea to the consulting for the Korean government and then financial investors. So I think this opportunity was great to understand what's happening in the U.S. and then to understand the coal business too. But I would like to, because Mr. Professor An mentioned a lot of great things about strategy, and then Mr. Ri also mentioned about great things. And then, but I think just to make that happen, I mean, that's essential between the U.S. and South Korea, we need to work together. Everybody understand, everybody agree that. But how to? That's the question next. I would like to make a comment about that, put your question too. Because Korea right now, South Korea, has like $1.2 trillion financial institutions. They are looking for invest. Like Japan, previous 1990s, the situation, they are looking for investment. Because they are short of the investment opportunity. And then Samsung, LG, GS, all the global companies, they are getting short of the opportunity in domestic investment. So they are looking for outside of the countries. I think those two kind of strategic investors and the financial investors, they are looking for working with the U.S. the business. And then Mr. Professor said about the two different levels, policymakers and then private equity fund level, the two different discussion. I think to make happen, I think starting from the business, the co-investment, like a coal export terminal. I think, as you mentioned, that it's clean coal, and then in the United States, there are no needs for the future for the clean coal. But still, in Korea, you're using the coal as a main resource for the power plant. But so co-investment together, bring the business to working together, and then I think build some more like long-term plan to work together. So starting from the business and small and like, for example, energy terminal, for like Korea, we import like 3.5 million tons, and almost from that Sabin Pass, and 2 million tons from the Freeport from 2019. We would need to see those things in coal area and light crude oil area to invest together, and that will be the main importer for those things. To make that happen, I think starting from the co-investment and strategic invest working together. That's why I would like to make comment on that, because even we talked about the policy level, but to make that happen, the business level need to start to talk to each other. And in the beginning stage of the business. That's why I would like to make comment. Thank you.
And one last thing, in terms of shale gas, LNG, I think that the amount of LNG Japan had secured right now, at the moment, I think is 25 million tons. Korea, 3.5 coal gas, and SKENS, private company, 2.4. So add up to maybe a little bit more than 5.4 million tons. It's a huge difference between Japan and Korea. This shows where Korea and Japan, right, goes in terms of, you know, Professor An discussed, you know, two geopolitical forces, right? Korea is straddled between, right? So business, I think, is important, and government, I think, direction is important. And I think in the future, there is a huge, I think, a drain on this kind of a energy security under President Park's government. Lee Myung-bak, I think he was on the right track, but I think we are a little bit drifting, you know, everywhere. So I think this will change. I think in terms of, I think Korea should catch up. I think, you know, this gap, 5 million ton, 25 million ton will catch up. I think that's, you know, that's his recommendation. And also, I think in terms of, you know, policy, we need to make that happen.
Yes, not only for the natural gas, I think I would make a comment is coal area and also the right area, because
I think because since I moved back to Korea, I can see that Korean companies, they are looking for coal investment. I think it's that story is not expanding to the U.S. Like when I talked last night to the people, still, like, because South Korea, I mean, as I mentioned, $1.2 trillion, they're looking for investment, they're supporting some Korean business. And then Korean government, I'm consulting Korean government right now, they're looking for the how to make a business with the U.S. And they are trying to support. But I think they couldn't find that that's the solution. I think this kind of the discussion and then this kind of the opportunity talking to each other would be great. And then,
well, is this LNG and coal?
Yeah, I mean, because first time right now, LNG, when we started 2 years ago, 2012, coal gas, they decided to import 3.5 million tons. And then right after that, the SKENS, they make agreement, additional 2 million tons. When I talked to the gentleman here, that they're looking for building that coal export terminal. And then because of the, and then Professor, the Mark, the you said about, the, like, I fully agree with your point. Because, but to make that happen, I think Asian countries that the business investment and working together, and that's the how I think we build that solution as a team together. That's what we
Yes, we have an answer.
Yeah,
here's
somebody.
One person in the back.
Microphone here.
Yes, I'm patient.
Hi, I'm Louise Thiemann from World Trade Center Tacoma, and I have a comment on both your point and yours, Mr. Thurber, that we receive over 200 predominantly Chinese investors per year at the Trade Center. We have another 50 coming between now and Thanksgiving. They are ready to make investments of anywhere from $5 million to half a billion dollars. But they ask the same couple of questions, which the fact that we have an incoherent environmental policy and regulatory policy in general, the two questions are, how long will it take from when I invest in this project to see a return on investment? And the second question is, what are the additional costs besides buying into the investment that I'm going to have to make? When you ask about that second question, it is entirely about the EPA or SEPA, if you're in Washington State. And so there is an opportunity cost here of sheer infrastructure investment dollars that is being lost because they walk away from not being able to make decisions about investment opportunities in infrastructure and in energy. We're fortunate in Tacoma, we have the new LNG plant coming in as well as the methanol plant. But there are enormous infrastructure tasks that have to be done to make those happen. Grade separations for the railroad, you know, there's transportation issues and other things there. But there is not a regulatory environment that will let investors who want to invest and who will benefit from it in China without a regulatory environment that will make those projects happen in a timely manner and in a predictable manner. And so if there's anything any of you can do to make that happen, that will be good.
Great comment.
Yeah. Go ahead. Yes.
Because you've talked about both energy and security. Me, personally, I would like to add one geopolitical issue here. So we heard a lot from Governor Locke about China's good nature of expanding their energy supply policy. But here, I'd like to remind you again that China is now proceeding with their One Belt and One Road policy. So as far as I understand, this has something to do with their energy supply. So they are devouring all energy, even from Africa. So in connection with this One Belt and One Road policy, the South Korean government is paying attention to this, and we would think that some Korean element can be added to this One Belt and One Road policy. So this is new, you know, element in geopolitics in Northeast Asia. Another thing is my new president is continuing, proceeding with the Eurasia Initiative. Eurasia Initiative means connecting Korean Peninsula with European market via Siberia. So this has something to do with the Russian gas project. So this is a very ambitious plan, but I don't think that it could bring very tangible results as soon as possible. This is one of our innovative initiatives. So now time has really come now for South Korea to have a Korea-Seattle initiative here. As we talked about here, this region is not very well known to East Asia as a hub of natural gas and LNG terminal in future. We are very anxious to see your you know, coal terminal and your LNG terminal here. So this would prompt our alliance and our economic, you know, cooperation between East Asia. East Asia will be remaining, you know, global engine of global economy. So I think that's why we need this kind of initiative. So I think, as far as I understand, this energy security is very coined combination of good words, yeah? But here we have many things, we can put everything here, but why not stressing, highlighting the importance of our energy and security cooperation between East Asia and this part of the United States. This is one comment. Another comment is about, you know, South Korean, the significance of South Korean energy market. I didn't recognize that South Korea is importing so much of energy. South Korea is, I think, in terms of volume and in terms of demand, and we are purchasing a lot of energy since 40 and 50 years because we don't have no natural resources. But over the past 50 years, we all went to Middle East. Here, you are just saying diversification is very good word. But to us, our dependence on Middle East is very much conveniently accepted in Korea because Middle Eastern countries, especially GCC countries, oil-producing countries gave us a lot of big construction projects. So we purchased, we had to buy their oil there, but we were given a lot of opportunities to make something there. So this is offset, sort of offset. So we are very much, you know, paying attention. Your future offset conditions to be given to East Asian countries. Without offset, I think not viable option for you to sell your good energy to East Asia. I think time has really come to devise this kind of offset conditions and to draw attention of East Asian countries. We East Asian countries will do explore a lot of initiatives. As we heard from Professor Han, South Korea is already planning to have our oil and gas hub in Northeast Asia. Even with this oil hub there, you'd like to allow oil trade there. So this is a new concept followed by to be following, you know, Singaporean case. So this is very new concept. So everything can be discussed here. But me, I'm not expert on this area. But whenever I enjoy your energy experts, you know, papers here, I'm always thinking this is not only energy but geopolitical game, and that's why we, after 70 years after the end of Second World War, we are still lead U.S. government's U.S. Constructive role in East Asia because this will guarantee the new order in East Asia.
Thank you. I think that summed up a lot of the Korean kind of perception. You know, where are we, Clara? Rich, we're at our witching hour, a little past it. Do we?
Yeah,
are you ready to?
I'd say last question.
Yeah. Any last comments? If you have a comment, you don't have to disguise it as a question. Any other thoughts, comments?
The man beside
Marianne. Oh, yeah. It's very hard for me to see back there.
This is Hal Burton, the Seattle Times. I just had one comment when everyone was talking about China and coal, and I know Mark made one brief comment about, well, we can't quite figure out what's going on with China here, so let's certainly not assume they're unhooked from coal. No one's assuming that they're unhooked from coal, but I think there should be some acknowledgement in this discussion of how radically different the current picture is from what all the best experts were saying 2 or 3 years ago about what China's coal trajectory looked like, and also about what that meant to markets, because China's coal demand was growing, its imports were rising, the market was red hot. That spurred a lot of interest, obviously, in our country in getting coal to Asia. And that all becomes a lot more difficult in an environment where China's coal consumption is flat, its imports are falling, even if you're not trying to send coal to China, which, of course, I know folks are sending it to Korea and everything. So my question is for Mark and others crystal balling, where are we? Where does it look like it might go from here? Is it a blip? It seems like it's looking less like a blip. Has China turned a corner where, sure, it still has enormous amounts of coal that it's consuming, but if it's not a big player in the import market, that has enormous impacts for coal trade, it seems to me.
Mark?
Yeah, well, I mean, so that's absolutely right in the sense that, I mean, I think, you know, even leaving aside the resistance to exports, I mean, I think right now the price environment is very unfavorable, probably, for those ports to begin with, and that is connected, I think. I mean, certainly the China demand seeming to really fall out is a big part of that. Yeah, I mean, I think all, I mean, the way that I'm sort of thinking about China is that they're still, I mean, you know, the pieces of it, right? So on the supply side, it's, okay, well, how much are they growing everything else relative to coal? And it's not obvious to me that there's been huge growth in alternatives. I mean, I think there's been unusually high hydro, you know, the past year or two. But it's not obvious, for example, that, you know, renewables are, I mean, obviously they're working on nuclear, they're working on gas, you know, they're working on renewables. But I, you know, I don't think structurally, I mean, so when Greenpeace sort of, you know, makes the, you know, the inference that, oh, well, you know, they're doing renewables, you know, it still seems like coal is that thing at the margin. But I think that's, I mean, I think it brings up an interesting question because I, you know, so maybe China's demand has really fallen out. Maybe the structural change in the economy is greater, you know, even than the official numbers are kind of letting on. So I don't know. I mean, maybe we do see a period where China, you know, doesn't get much stronger as far as demand. I think, though, another interesting piece of it is that, you know, how long is it going to take the rest of the world to sort of develop? I mean, and so I think in a way we're maybe almost over-focused at times on China. I mean, understandably so, because, you know, China is such a huge coal market that any little residual has huge effects on the international trade. But I think an interesting question to me is, well, you know, ASEAN, you know, where's that kind of going? And then even longer term, you know, what's going to happen? Like, so if we're really, you know, talking about developing the big countries in Africa, you know, the Nigerias of the world, you know, getting more reliable power, you know, places like Bangladesh, you know, just where that supply comes from. But you know, it's just really hard for me to answer the China question right now because I just, you know, even looking at, I mean, I've kind of poured through the Greenpeace analysis and there's so many assumptions, right, about, you know, whether we know, like China's coal production figures, right, are notoriously unreliable. You know, Kevin Tu, who worked on the book with us, I mean, he actually tried to make some estimate of how much unofficial production there was because, you know, when the government says, we'll shut down all these small mines, they'll certainly stop reporting those mines production, but those small mines are revenues for the local government, and so often they'll keep running even if they're not reporting. So I'm struggling right now, frankly, on understanding what's happening with China, and all I can sort of think of is that, you know, if this is a real structural kind of long-term change, that it's something about the economy, you know, shifting what it looks like more quickly than people thought. But I, you know, I'm interested if anyone else has
Clara,
insights
wanna,
on that. Yeah.
Clara?
Thank you. And Hal, I'd like to say I love that question because it also gives me a chance to promote our own research here at NDR. Last year, we did a major study on China's energy outlook. And one of the essays commissioned by Li Zhidong looked specifically at China's coal demand outlook. The broad range of studies that have been done by numerous institutions, both inside China and out,
And a couple of the conclusions that he came to was, yes, it's incredibly difficult to say where Chinese coal demand is going to land, even ignoring the economic growth situation, which further complicates it. There are a number of studies that say we could see that peak coal demand has already happened, a number that say this is, in fact, a blip, we should push it out, and regardless of that timeline, whether that peak is now or later. What he went from there is saying, yes, it is hard to guess the exact number, but that doesn't change a couple other facts. One, we can say that it's still going to be incredibly significant. Still see it's probably going to be around, you know, half of world demand. It's going to be a huge impact on the market. And in addition to that, just because we're uncertain about where it may land in some ways, it doesn't excuse the fact that policymakers still need to be moving forward now. We need to be pushing forward on some of the new clean air laws. I think the cap and trade was just announced. There are still very real things that we need to be doing and we should be focusing on for policy to make sure that coal that is used in a more sustainable way.
What?
You know, I mean, I say that and I'm thinking about the actions that Chinese policymakers should take, but there's also a big question for the way that the U.S. and China can be working together on that, so ourselves as partners.
Let me just add one little wrinkle here. As I've watched this pretty closely, and I would recommend the Li Jiadong piece of our report last year because it's superb. I thought China coal, capping China coal use by 2020 was a pipe dream, and just absolutely, you know, magical thinking. But in fact, that's kind of where we're going if you watch it very closely. One wrinkle here to keep in mind, the explosion, coal is about electricity, largely in China. There was an explosion in electricity consumption during the Nazis, the 2000 to 2010, during the explosion of heavy industry investment in China. Concrete, steel, aluminum, glass, the urbanization of 20 million people a year moving into Chinese city, building that out. So there was literally 10, 15% annual increases in electricity consumption in China for a decade. And China's electricity consumption doubled over the period of about 12 years. I mean, this is a staggering change. What's happening with the readjustment? What industries are getting hit the hardest with consolidation, overcapacity? Steel, aluminum, glass, cement, all the things that that drove the electricity curve in the 2000s are now disproportionately getting hit with slowdowns, and so the electricity consumption curve has just dropped off the table. It's kind of a one-off, but it signals a trajectory of electricity demand that's going to be much lower than what we experienced for that decade of 2000, which was a total aberration. I can show you the charts, but so I think we're normalizing in China. We're now below the natural curve. Of this, even with the restructuring of the economy, we'll probably come back up to a more normal developing country electricity curve somewhere in the next few years as we get work through the overcapacity and everything else in the heavy industry of the Chinese economy. This is a structural change that's very important.
That's right, yes. So the service sector is growing now still in China in a healthy manner, very healthy manner, and the mining, manufacturing, and so on is not. So what then, so to put a percentage to it, what level of growth then should we expect in electricity consumption in China? What's the demand curve there? Is it 2% a year? Is it 5% a year? What's the growth?
Well, tell me the economic growth rate, and then I can tell you, you know, better. If we let's assume China's growing that for the next 5 years at 6%,
yeah,
something like that, GDP. A typical developing country elasticity, another relationship between electricity consumption and GDP, would be something close to 1-to-1. And so you would get 5-6% electricity consumption growth. Maybe a little bit less as you move towards services. That's much less energy intensive. So that's going to bring your elasticity down. But I think in the near future, it'd be something around GDP growth or something maybe slightly less. That would seem to me to be a natural a trajectory. Once you strip out the heavy industry, boom and bust that were that are affecting the electricity curve.
I think that gets right to the question that was asked. So in other words, we're still looking at electricity consumption growth.
Yeah.
Just not the astronomical growth that took place.
Yeah. And one other item here to keep in mind, and this came from another person at our meeting last year. 2013 was the first year that the additions to power generation, the new build power generation for the year 2013, it was the first year that thermal sources, that's basically coal, were less than 50% of the new build. In other words, more than 50% were hydro, nuclear, wind, and solar, you know, cleaner electricity sources. I would have bet 2 years ago this was simply not possible. And if you look at the additions to capacity, yes, they're still building coal, but they're coming on with a lot of these other things that are beginning to make a dent in the coal use for that coal electricity nexus. But these are only very recent kind of developments. I haven't.
New coal plants are more efficient, and the old plants they shut down are less efficient. So even when you get a new coal plant, you may get a net drop in consumption.
Absolutely, absolutely. They're becoming much more efficient. Ultra supercritical, instead of pulverized coal, basic stuff. So, I think there are real things happening here, and the Li Jiadong paper that we have may be slightly optimistic, but I think it's pointing to some very fundamental changes. And I was 3 years ago, I would have just laughed you out of the room if you had said that. And so, I think it's, and the reason I think it's durable is that. The leadership is deathly afraid of the air pollution, political, social problem. It's not climate change. It's the air pollution problem that they can't hide. It's not like corruption and everything else that they can hide. They cannot hide this. It's in everybody's face every day. And the leadership is desperately worried about the political implications of this and the social unrest that's coming. So that's the forcing process that's forcing them to really go after coal. And really go after air pollution and other problems, but that means coal. So it's more than just kind of a short-term blip, I think.
Yeah, it's funny. We started the whole day with Gary talking about the fascinating role that the U.S. Embassy played in highlighting the pollution, the air pollution.
Yeah. Well, any last comments? Slade, did you want to say something?
No, I wanted to see if there was anybody else.
Anybody else? What? Yes. Yes.
I just had a question for Mark, actually. You talked about coherent climate policy. And I'd like to hear what you would think that would look like in order to get people to say yes to coal or LNG exports. Because I completely agree. I think people are trying to fight the climate fight on individual projects. I think we see that in Canada. We see it in the United States. What do you think would take the sting out of, or the concerns out of, or at least to some extent, of these projects? Like, what does that policy look like?
Well, I think to me it's a carbon price, right? So I think if you had a revenue neutral national carbon price, just like British Columbia, right? Then I think you have a good argument to say, look, this is our mechanism for dealing with this issue. The local environmental impact review process is not the mechanism for dealing with a global problem. It's something, and I don't know if the politics in Washington State may well not be amenable to this, but I mean, you could even have something like that at a state level, right? Saying, well, we're going to, we want to clarify things. We're going to put in place a clear climate policy. We're going to put in a revenue neutral carbon tax in Washington State, right? And then we're going to, try to separate that issue from the approval of the export terminals. That's kind of what it would be for me. And not that exactly compensates. I mean, obviously the carbon content of the coal that you export, I mean, that could be much more than, any sort of tax on operations, right? But I think it just shows that look, we're acknowledging in a concrete way that this is a real problem. We're acting on it. This is our mechanism for acting on it. This is not. So let's, yeah.
All right.
Any other final?
Yeah, I heard Mike.
Well, I think we've covered a lot of ground, and I think everybody's been very patient at working through all these issues. I want to thank our panelists for giving us lots of material to work with. I apologize to you last two squeezing you on the time so much. It's but that's a function of a good discussion. You know, those things happen.
Yeah. So, yes.